theme is patriotism begins with truth, and it will be focused on education. We'll be talking about the book bannings and all sorts of things there. Abigail Spanberger will be there. Sarah will be there. We'd love for you to come, and I can make sure that you have the link for tickets if anybody would like to come. So. They help with curriculum development and teacher training and resources. you know, all that went well and was very constructive. And then COVID hit, and the mask controversy came up, and then critical race theory, that whole controversy erupted. And I have to say that I think that is one of the most damaging things that has happened. It has caused so much division in communities coast to coast. It's completely false. It's completely manufactured. So much misinformation, and it's just really unfortunate. The whole CRT and equity, you know, anti-equity sentiment that's out there, you know, it's really disappointing, and it's very prevalent in Madison. People really bought into it, and they were fueled, in particular, by two people, two white men who ran for school board office in November 21. And were elected. They were very, very conservative. They were running against two women that we were quietly but robustly supporting, who were so well qualified. One was a former teacher of the year. They both had advanced degrees. One was an Army vet, a nurse. They were just terrific women and would have been terrific on the school. But these gentlemen who had spoken out against masks and against equity work and CRT and against any kind of accommodation for trans students or LGBTQ students, they had spoken out on all of that and they were let. So that was really disappointing. And then our saga really begins because they took office in January of 2022. So now, the two people they replaced were much more progressive and moderate. So now we have a real swing to a much more conservative board. And I just, because I don't want to take too long, but I put together a little greatest hits list of the things that they have focused on. And it's been really alarming. Very beginning. I want to mention, and I mentioned this at the coffee, that in addition to going to the school board meetings, which are so important, and hearing the public comments and having a chance to participate in the public comments, it's really important to attend, and again, this is where publications like Chuck's really help out. It's important to attend or be aware of what's going on in the work sessions and budget sessions and the retreats. So these are public meetings, but you won't have a chance to have any public comment. But you can really learn a lot about the perspectives, the priorities, the concerns of school board members, because they'll just talk openly about things that are on their mind, and you really get a sense in Madison of what antics they're up to or what they're plotting, what's coming up next. So in February of 2022, I went to this now newly formed school board retreat, which was 3 hours on a Saturday morning. I couldn't talk, just had to sit there and grit my teeth. And I'm just going to start in with some of the things that came up. The first thing was, you cannot say equity. No longer can we say equity. None of the materials in the Madison County Schools will reference the word equity. The task force will be, because we had a diversity, equity, and inclusion task force, the EI task force. That has to be renamed. It'll be the diversity, opportunity, inclusion. You cannot say equity. It's too toxic a word. Because I'm sitting next to you. No, it's not part of our family life education. We're not promoting abortions in schools. And then he went on to suggest that he was a supporter of, and I think this is a Nick Frias bill, the education savings something account bill. And this was a bill that would divert public school funding to parents so they can use it for private schools or homeschooling, which unfortunately didn't pass. But Mr. Sheets let everybody know that he, a school board member for a public school district, supported taking money away from the students and sending it to parents for private school education. So that was pretty shocking. And Mr. Sheets was really on a roll because the next thing he brought up was firearms. So it was his idea. This was at another meeting on the road that we should allow all of our teachers, if they choose to carry firearms in the schools and the classrooms. And Ms. Graham, to her credit, said, "Well, let's do a survey," and which has been her response to a lot of things. It's very pretty creative. Let's do a survey and see what the teachers think. And it was pretty overwhelming. I think it was something like 75% of the teachers said, absolutely not, terrible idea. I think Mad Rap actually reported the comments, all the anecdotal comments that people had said, you know, I would quit immediately, this is a terrible idea. So that was quieted down. And it's against the law in Virginia to do that, to carry firearms in schools for teachers anyway. But he wanted to be ready in case, and I think he actually said, in case the General Assembly changes and that law is overturned, he wanted to be ready. So that was one of his contributions. And then we get to the big issue of censorship. And this began back in the spring when the school board was reviewing the request from the school administration to purchase new literature textbooks for the middle school and high school. They were, our past textbooks were very out of date. And the administration had been meeting for months and they had chosen these textbooks, but they needed approval from the school board. And Mr. Wingate, he was concerned, and he said, "I want 30 days delay to look over the textbooks," which was a meaningful delay because the teachers needed to get the new textbooks in over the summer and they needed to get oriented and all of that. But it was delayed for 30 days, and then he came back 30 days later and said, absolutely not. These textbooks are very progressive. They only have a progressive perspective. There's no enough conservative viewpoint. And Mr. Sheed said, why can't we just get conservative textbooks? Let's go back to the drawing board and get conservative textbooks. And there was quite a bit of debate about it, and what they ended up doing, and it is my sincere hope that this can be revisited, but what they ended up doing was approving the textbooks, although Mr. Sheets and Mr. Wingate voted against it, but it passed on a 3-2 margin. They approved the textbooks, but Mr. Wingate produced a list of 13 texts from the textbook, high school textbook, that he objected to for reasons of either being unpatriotic, does not reflect a love of country, or respect for the military. That was one category. Another category was does not reflect a respect for traditional family. And the third category was does not show respect for faith and religion.
What was left?
This one just really broke my heart because the text that they banned, and I printed out a list for you, there's several copies in the back, but the 13 texts that they banned included James Baldwin's letter to his nephew written in 1963 called My Dungeon Shook. It's the opening essay in The Fire Next Time. It's absolutely beautiful. It's every school child. Whether they reflect the love of country and patriotism. Margaret Atwood's My Life is a Bat. There was something by Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Anyway, the whole list is back there. Now, this is something that I really have a problem with because, to me, it seems clearly unconstitutional. There's the Iowa Trees decision, which dealt with censorship in schools that predates the 1980s. Clearly says that government cannot censor texts based on ideology ideas. So I think that is something that can be revisited. I think it's pretty clear what the law says. And I'm hoping, I've had some encouraging talks with folks, that we might bring this up again and perhaps revisit it. And then the final big censorship issue, the one that went viral nationally, was the 21 books that were banned from the high school library. Mr. Wingate marched in one day with a list for Focus on the Family and had the 21, or I think it was actually a few more than that initially, pulled off the shelves. And of course, our library, like I assume here in Greene County, has a system, the Destiny system, where our parents can say, I don't want my children or my child to read this or that book. And it's noted in the Destiny. So there already was a structure, a mechanism in place if parents had any concerns. But that wasn't good enough for Mr. Wingate, so he took all the books off the shelves. And ultimately, the decision was made, and this did pass, I believe, 5-4 with one abstention, to remove the books altogether. And that included 3 or 4 books by Toni Morrison, Stephen King, Margaret Atwood, David Peterson's Snow Falling on Cedars, which is a beautiful book, a long list. And a reporter, I think he covers rural areas from Virginia, I think he's from Daniel Roanoke, he tweeted about this. He said, and all he said was, Madison County School Board votes to ban these books, and he listed all 21. And that went viral. And so that came to the attention of Stephen King, who tweeted about it. It came to the attention of Margaret Atwood, who wrote an article in The Atlantic about it, calling out Madison County. Jody Pipo, Joel Hill, Sharon Neinfeld, I mean, just lots of scholars and university professors, and just people. It got more than 5 million views.
And Mad Rap got 100,000 hits that time, so
yep.
We appreciate that.
And it's really unfortunate because, you know, Stephen
King, and that was my best buddy.
So it's really been frustrating. The latest thing, and this came up again on Monday night school board meeting, which I zoomed in on. Now Mr. Wingate wants to go after social and emotional learning, SEL, which you may know is kind of inherent in a lot of districts as a program to promote empathy and compassion and discipline, self-regulation, and self-awareness. And, you know, I think the Madison schools really focused on a Be Kind campaign for quite a while. So I think that there's a concern that that may be just too progressive,
too new age.
Does that include, do we have to be compassionate and supportive of, you know, the LGBTQ community? What exactly are we talking about here? Does that mean we make accommodations for them? Is that part of this? It's just too blurry around the edges. So they're concerned about it. And the goal for Mr. Wingate is to sort of replace it with a very patriotic, love America, serve your country, be a good citizen, kind of, you know, more rigorous. I'm projecting there, but that seems to be where it's going. And We held our first meeting in February, just met again in March, and what are we talking about? The teachers and the counselors are saying, before we can do anything, before we can close achievement gaps, before we can make up for the lost ground due to the pandemic, before we do anything, our kids are hungry. They're coming to school and they're hungry. The lunch debt, I mentioned that earlier from a few years ago, but I learned this year the lunch debt is much higher. It's $19,000 now overall in the school system that kids are not able to pay for their lunches. Teachers and counselors are packing backpacks every weekend to send food home for the weekend. They are keeping snacks in their classrooms. They're trying to keep breakfast bars and all kinds of things. They're hungry. And you're not going to focus on your education when you're hungry, right? And another issue that came up is laundry. Kids don't have washers and dryers at home. Some of them don't have electricity. They don't have running. My son is a substitute teacher at the elementary school. And he came home a couple weeks ago and said one of the kids came up to him and said, my mom picked my dad and I out of the house, and we've been living in a camper for a few months. So, you know, what do they have, you know, as far as laundry or whatever? There's no laundromat in Madison, so it's a real burden on families. This leads to bullying. These kids are coming to school with poor hygiene, and they don't have clean clothes, and so it leads to bullying, or it leads to absenteeism. They just stay home. So that's another focus. So we're focusing on food insecurity, this DOI committee, and we're focusing on laundry. And one of the ideas is to open up a high school home economics lab where there is a washer dryer. Open it up on the weekends, staff it with volunteers. Get, you know, donations of laundry, detergent, so on. Get families in and out, you know, as quietly as possible and get their laundry done. And then the other thing that this is the committee that I've been assigned to is strengthening our community ties between the school system and businesses, other nonprofits, and so on. We've got a big budget shortfall. We've got a lot of issues with families in need. How can we strengthen the ties and get more business and community support? And this is something that, again, I think might help with catching us up with the pandemic a little bit. If we can have more businesses coming in for mentoring and tutoring and internships and visits to you know, local industry and so on. Sponsorships, you know, sponsor this football game or sponsor this concert. Brings the money into the schools. This is the committee that I'm working, subcommittee that I'm working on is you know, how can we create a value proposition for our local businesses and other organizations and say, hey, you know, get on board and come in and help our schools. Here are some ways that you can do, here are the avenues, and here's what it might mean to you. So we're working on that. I think that's mostly it. I did bring a lot of materials that I have in the back. Some I just brought some copies of newspapers, but others are actually handouts to the committee. I'm also, as Susan mentioned, with the NAACP, and we have a very robust education committee. So we have been, both the NCTC and the NAACP education committee have been working hard on kind of tracking what our school is doing and what the state is doing as well. Several of us spoke at the Piedmont Community College when we were discussing the standards of learning last month. We've issued statements. We held an education forum in Madison where we tried to explain what equity work was and why it's important. We had a real good turnout for that. So there's some handouts back there about that, and then some letters to the editor. I mean, one of the things one of the school board members said to me, we were doing our Thanksgiving shopping. We happened to run into each other in the grocery store. And I just was going to say hello and walk on. She grabbed me and she said, I just want to tell you that I want to thank you for coming to speak at the school board meeting. important. And, you know, what I've been able to see is by being present and making a meaningful contribution in terms of, for example, the food insecurity and the laundry, et cetera, you know, we're trying to do good, and we're trying to do good for the students. And it's not all just bashing each other in the newspapers. It's, you know, we're trying to do some good things. And I think some school board members are sort of noticing that maybe we shouldn't be focusing on this greatest hits list of craziness. Maybe we should be focusing on things like making sure kids are fed. So, I think that's it.
I heard a discussion before.